I decluttered this 2,800 square foot house from this to that in just 6 weeks. It wasn't easy, but it can be done. So here are 10 things I learned so that you are more prepared when it's time for your next decluttering project, whether it's a space or a whole house, or when it's time to downsize. Hi, I'm Simply Sherry, and I empower working moms to flourish by creating a home you love. Last year, I did a video sharing about how I lost my dad and the things that I was processing at that time. So here we are several months later. The house is now on the market, and I did a whole video series showing you each section of us decluttering the house. And so you can watch that in that video, or you can watch the other video where I just share about my loss. And that's important because I've never had to declutter a whole house, and very sentimental things and memories kept popping up. And you know, we're still grieving. I had to move my mom, and she's now living near me, and she's settled into her new place. So things, you know, are moving forward. And you know, once in a while I have that wave of grief, but this is something in my life that had to be taken care of. So I just wanted to share with you the things that I learned, because I think it will be very helpful whether you're in the process now or it's going to happen in the future. So number one is you can't do it alone. Even if you haven't had a loss and you're decluttering, it's a lot of work, and there's a lot of you know, just energy, there's emotional work, there's sentimental items. And sometimes it's hard to make decisions, obviously, when it's sentimental stuff. And so even sometimes the magnitude of the work, you can't do it alone. And I say I did it in 6 weeks, and we're talking about just like 4 hours a week, maybe a half day, because we can only go on the weekends. It's the house is 45 minutes away. And of course I work, my husband works, my daughter's in school. And the time we had was either on a Saturday or a Sunday. So if I were to do that by myself, I mean, it would be more than 6 weeks. At times my husband helped, my daughter helped the whole time. I hired a few times from Upwork. I hired a couple friends. My son had come home for the holiday, so he helped for a day. We hired a junk removal. So you'll see all those videos if you want to watch that playlist. But again, you can't do it alone. Try to get a family member, whether it's in your immediate family or a cousin or an aunt or a nephew, friends, people maybe at church, maybe in your community, a neighbor. They don't have to do it the whole time, but they can come in chunks of 2 hours or 4 hours, whatever their time or their energy allows them. It's going to be very helpful for you. And depending on your budget, you can hire help. So for Upwork, I had a few times where they came in just to get the stuff from Goodwill, because we went through every piece of paper, every kitchen item, every tool in the garage. I mean, we went through everything. We touched everything. We looked at everything before we either trashed it, donated it, or are still going through it. And I'll talk about that later. So again, depending on your budget, you might have to hire outside help, junk removal, which is what we did, and it was fantastic. The second thing I learned is that you will be making a lot of decisions. When you're gonna go, how you're going to do that, who you're going to recruit, how many hours you'll be able to declutter as far as chunks of time, and you'll be making decisions about sentimental clutter. So be prepared that you will be making a lot of decisions. Are these going to go and donate? Is this trash? Will I hire someone for this? Will I wait for so-and-so to help me when I tackle that room? So you will be making a lot of decisions, but it's okay, you got this. The third thing I learned is that you will be making continuous decisions. So it's not just one decision, oh, I'm going to declutter this house because I got to put on the market, or we need to downsize because my mom will be moving closer to me, or whatever your situation or scenario is. It's not just a one-time decision. So aside from a lot of decisions, it will be continuous. Because for example, you go there, let's say on a Saturday, and you have 4 hours of time. Now you go to the bedroom, the closet, and you're going to declutter that. Should I keep this pillow? Does so-and-so want it? Do they need a bed? Who may want a bed? Where should I donate it? Does my nephew want this jacket? Should I keep these hangers? Do I need more hangers in my house? Are these shoes good enough for Goodwill, or should we trash them? Should I have the junk removal take care of this? Should I hire someone for that? So it's not just a lot, but it's one after another. And so that was something that I became aware of, because at first, I mean, I'm very project oriented. So I thought, okay, I'm just going to go in. We have 4 hours. We're going to tackle the bedroom, this hallway, and the bathroom, including the two closets there. But I noticed, like, if I had my daughter or I had two people helping me that day, they would ask questions. So I'm also making decisions from their questions. Where should we put this? What about this? What about that? So be ready, you know, and they're not necessarily always hard decisions. Sometimes they're little decisions, but there's a few of them at a time. Number four, declutter one section at a time. So if you watch my series, you can see that that's completely what I did with this house. It was one section at a time. So for me, my mind was I started in one corner of the house, which is the bedroom, the closet, the bathroom in that hallway. There's a hallway closet. Then it goes to the laundry room. It's right there, kind of when you enter from the garage. For you, you may think of, let me do all the bedrooms. Let me do all the closets and then move on to the kitchen. Or let me start from the outside of the house, the backyard, the garage, or let me tackle the toughest parts, which may be the garage or the room that has the most stuff or the space that has the least stuff. Whatever works in your mind that is going to keep you motivated, then do it that way. So for me, the reason I say one section, okay, and even if you go from the outside in or the rooms with the with more items, for me, that's still a section. Okay, I'm gonna work on this room with the most items, or it seems like a little bit tougher. This is still a section. You take care of that section, then you move on to the next bedroom, or you move on to the pantry. But if you say, let me declutter the whole house, okay, that's just overwhelming. But when you hit one section at a time and you get that done, so when you get that bedroom done, it's a victory. Okay, now this bedroom is finished, you can check that off. Or this bathroom is finished, you can check it off. Or you can even go into smaller sections. So example, in the kitchen, it was a relatively, I think it was a pretty decent sized kitchen. It's bigger than my kitchen, but they had a walk-in pantry. So we did the cabinets first, the pantry, the island, and the kitchen nook. So those are four areas, four sections in the kitchen. It's part of the kitchen. So if I were to say, let me declutter the kitchen, that's a lot of stuff. But when I just focused on the cabinets, we got that done, whatever, trash, Goodwill, donate, people who are helping me kept it. Then it just felt more achievable, right? It was like, how do you eat an elephant? One bite at a time. How do you declutter a house? One section at a time. Number five, you will encounter unexpected sentimental clutter. Now, when I went to go take care of this house, I knew there was going to be sentimental clutter. My parents had lived there for 15 years. They've been married for 55 plus years. So there are definitely items that I had grown up with. And if you watch the whole video series, you'll see that the section in the bedroom, I was very was surprised, I guess, by all the sentimentality I felt towards the record albums. And it just brought up memories of my cousins and I, because they lived only a house away from us. All the, you know, in their basement, we would play the record player and dance and do all kinds of fun things. You know, back then there wasn't all this online stuff, so you had to play, or you had to go play outside, right? So it just brought up a lot of memories. So I was very, had decided to keep the record albums. Now, there were other things that it brought up a lot of memories. It brought up a lot of emotions, whether good, bad, you know, a lot of times was just happy. It was like, it tickled me pink, right? But I couldn't keep everything. And so if every emotion was good and I kept that item, then I would need another house, right? So that's not going to work. So my suggestion is that there will be items that are unexpected, right? That you'll come across like, oh my gosh, I didn't realize they still kept this or they had this. Like they had my cotillion dress when I was 16, and I'm not 16 anymore. I'm 16 plus plus plus. Okay. Actually I'll be 55 this summer. So I'm actually, side note, I'm thinking of what should I do for my 55th birthday, because I will now be entitled to the senior discounts. Oh my goodness. Okay. Yeah, that should be a whole nother video. Okay. Anyway, what was I saying? Okay. I was talking about my cotillion dress when I was 16. Well, I can't keep that dress. My closet is already at the capacity that I want it to be. And I had already made a decision. If I bring something new, something has to come out because I don't want to expand into other areas of my house just because I have the space. So, be aware that you will face unexpected sentimental clutter. So now as we continue talking about sentimental clutter, number six is there are different ways you can deal with sentimental clutter. I would say the number one thing is to celebrate. If an item reminds you of a time in your life where it was just a good time, you were happy, you had fun, then celebrate that memory. Celebrate that item has reminded you of that. The other thing it can also bring is just, deep thoughts about, or assessment or analysis or just observation of your family. And so for me, I had run into this, which was an unexpected sentimental clutter, was a lotion dispenser that it's like shaped like a pitcher. And wait, hold on, let me go grab it because I kept it. All right, so here it is. It's a yellow pitcher with white speckles. My mom has used this forever. So you're talking about like from the 80s, all right? When I was growing up in our childhood home. So I'm keeping it. I saved it for now to show you in this video. And I'd forgotten to bring it up. But anyway, I'm gonna bring this to my mom's new place. I'll put her lotion in here because it's now just the regular store-bought dispenser. So I'll put it in here. And so some sentimental items, you're going to keep it because it's still going to be used. So my mom will be using this. And then I also found this. Okay, it's a vase for a single bud. Now, if this does not shout 1970s or maybe 60s, who knows? I'm not very good at that. But this shouts my childhood home. And so I'm keeping this because my mom has a table, and so I can put a flower in here when I go visit her. And it's also something that I like. I like kind of the mid-century vibe. So as far as sentimental clutter, you know, you handle it in different ways. So some items you're going to keep and use them. Other items you're just going to celebrate and let it go. Another thing you could do is digitize, right? You may, if you didn't want to keep these, you have items like this, then take a picture. And maybe 2 years later, you're scrolling through your photos for whatever reason, you're trying to look for a picture or you're trying to organize your photos, you might come across that picture and it's going to bring you that joy again, that happiness, those tickle me pink memories, right? Another thing is you can give it to someone you care about, right? That can use it. Or if it's an heirloom, definitely I would use, even with heirlooms, you have to decide which ones you're going to keep or to whom you're going to pass them on to. Or you can save them for later. So what I did was I rented a storage unit. I have a whole video for that. For those items that I have to think about, a lot of it was actually more paperwork where I have to go through the paperwork. So we did go through the paper, like we saw, okay, this packet is for this, but let me go through it later because either we can digitize it or I need to confer with my brother if it's something we actually need to keep because he's taking care of the financial stuff for my mom. Yeah, so those are the main things. It's like you could either you celebrate, keep and use it, give it to someone else, put it in a storage unit for or just save it for later. Maybe you can't just make a decision at this point or digitize it. I want to circle back to this item, and I was talking about how certain items, they bring back memories or they give you deeper observations or analysis or assessments of life, okay? And so this is not about a dispenser for lotion. It's about my mom being an Avon lady. So this is from Avon, and I remember back in, let's say the 80s when we were growing up, she became an Avon lady. So she was doing this side hustle for a few years. So she would have her full-time job, drive 45 minutes to her office, then drive back right after a long day, cook dinner for us. So we always had a homemade meal, and we were three kids growing up. So I can understand how, why she had the side hustle, probably to make ends meet. We were not, we didn't have a lot of money by any means, but we were always taken care of. And I can see the work ethic of my parents, that all three of us went to college, and not that it's something you need to do, but none of us had to, well, my older brother had a different path, but I never had to pay a dime for my college education because my parents took care of it. And I had moved from Illinois to California to go to Berkeley. And the first year was out-of-state tuition. And they took care of everything, my housing, my food, everything, because they worked hard. And so this is a symbol of, you know, them immigrating here to America from the Philippines. They landed in Virginia. My mom took a job as a secretary, and she moved up the ladder in the company that she ended up with. She stayed there for 25 years. And remember, the work landscape was a lot different in the early 70s, right? And my dad had taken a job as a construction worker. He had a civil engineering degree. Finally, took whatever exams he had to take to become licensed. And so he ended up with working those many years with the government. And I even saw, when we were going through stuff, awards that he got for his job, and my mom too, awards that she got for her work. And so it's just a reminder of the work ethic, the hustle that my parents did to, you know, make sure that we were okay, we were taken care of, and not even just okay, but more than okay. So it's a great reminder. And so I celebrate with this reminder from this item, their work ethic, their service, how they showed their love that way. And so anyway, when you run into an item, you know, take the time to take it in and celebrate. Number seven, it's okay to not be okay. You know, my profession, I'm a professional organizer, and it was so different, so different. Decluttering this house versus even decluttering my own house or helping other people declutter their homes, because there is so much more tie to my childhood than even my own house. Because a lot of the stuff in my own house is not from my childhood. It was from when I got married to my husband, which we'll be celebrating 30 years next year. So it was different. And so it's okay to not be okay. It is an emotional time, right? You're not only navigating the loss of your loved one, but you are dealing possibly with taking care of your other loved one, moving them, right? Anytime you have major life events like that, it's stressful, but it's not just stressful, it's emotional. So you have to make sure to take care of yourself. And it did work out that we could only go on weekends, because the only week where I was like there four times that week was towards the end, where I had the people who needed to clean the carpets, the junk removal, person to fix the AC. Those were the days I was like every other day. But aside from that, I think it was good to have that week or 2 week break in between so that I could take care of myself. It's okay to feel. Like I said, this is an emotional time. There's not just with the items, but the people that you're taking care of or have taken care of. and, you know, allow yourself to feel, because if you keep that in, you stuff it here, it's going to stay in your body. It stays in your shoulders. It goes into your neck, right? And that's not good for you. You need to take care of yourself. And then as you feel, it's okay to take the time to appreciate the memories. You know, a lot of the time, let's say we only had 2 hours or 4 hours, and I work fast. I was making those decisions, and then I'm just like completely exhausted, right? But anyway, in those times, when I ran into a memory, you know, I took my time. I looked at it, you know, I held it, I laughed, I told whoever was there, who was willing to listen to me about the item. You know, it's part of the processing, right? It's part of the grief. It's part of moving forward. And then it's okay to take your time, unless, you know, you're on a deadline, but you are more important than taking care of getting rid of all this stuff or taking care of all these things, right? It's okay to take your time. Take a deep breath, you know, take care of yourself, and, you know, you'll be fine. Number 8, be open to new solutions. So the number one new solution for me was to actually rent a storage unit, and it's still rented. I haven't gotten to it. You know, life is busy. I mean, it took 3 to 5 months to finally find a good place for my mom to move to. And then it's taken a few months for her to settle in. So that is a lot, okay? And let me know in the comments. Do you guys understand this? If you've been through it, let us know in the comments. You know, tell the community what you went through. Give examples, give some tips, give some advice. We all need it. This is not an easy thing to get through, but you can do it. So I'm normally against getting a storage unit for anything. And someone has suggested rent a storage unit, put the stuff in there that you can't decide on right now or that you can deal with later, have it near your home so that when the time comes when you're ready, it's near your place, you can go there and take care of it. And it's one of the best advice solutions that has been given to me. Because example, there's a lot of paperwork that, like I said, we went through and we saw, okay, this is for this, this is for that. But to go through that and scan and all that, whatever we decide to do with it, I just didn't have the time for that. So putting it in the storage unit for now is the best choice. Now, there are some other items like household items that I kept where I thought, okay, let me think about this some more. So I have that breathing room, that breathing space to take my time a little bit more with those items that are in the storage unit. Now, of course, we don't want this to go on for 3 years, but you know, you could put a deadline for yourself or you don't have to. It's up to you. It's up to your budget, right? Maybe some of you are not into asking for help. Okay, you just have to throw that out the window, because I don't know how I would have ever done this by myself. That's why that was my number one point. Okay, but you have to be open to that. Don't be embarrassed. People want to help. There are people who do this for a living. There are people who are willing to do it for free. You just have to ask. You just have to open your mind to that new solution. Okay, even the junk removal was something somewhat new. Like, I'm not new to it. I know when to use a junk removal. But in my mind, I thought, you know what? I can get this done. We don't really need like a junk removal. We just need, you know, maybe a few trips or somebody pick up a few things. No. If you watch that video, you will see it was 3 loads. 2,800 pounds, 2,500 pounds, 2,500 pounds. I mean, I tried my best to get through all of it and be like, goodwill, trash, right? Give it to someone else. But it was just too much stuff. And I went through all those, like my brothers didn't want them anymore. My family didn't want anything. The neighbor, he was great. He was totally helpful. Doesn't want anything. I mean, it wasn't necessarily stuff I would sell or even bring to Goodwill. So it was like, it was junk removal stuff. So that really opened, and the guy was fantastic. The company was fantastic. But it opened my eyes to, you know what? Sometimes it's just really a lot of stuff that needs to be unloaded in that matter or in that manner. And then even what I mentioned earlier is tackling the space one section at a time or one room at a time, one drawer, one area. Break it down into more bite-sized pieces. And maybe I've repeated this, but number 9, I put hire help if you can. Now that's different from asking for help. We're talking about hired, because if I didn't hire those 3 people for those 3 times, three times from Upwork to just bring stuff to Goodwill, that would have been my time. And it literally took them, 2 guys the first time, 2 hours to bring stuff back and forth to Goodwill. And I even hired a U-Haul van. So it's not like we brought it in like little mini cars, right? I mean, it was a good space. And then the second guy, I just remember 4 times. Anyway, the second guy, he had a minivan and that took him 4 hours. And then the junk removal also brought stuff to Goodwill. So if you have the budget, if you have the means, look into it. Just Google junk removal and the name of your city and things will pop up. Look at the reviews and give a couple calls. They can give quotes. They can stop by and give a quote and make your choice, because it did cost us for that junk removal. The Upwork, you can find someone that will, you know, kind of the middle or lower range. But so that's a little bit more, not as expensive or, you know, cost less. You could do it that way. But there's no way with all the stuff we had, we really needed a junk removal company. All right. Then lastly, number 10, keep the end goal in mind. Keep the end goal in mind. So for me, the end goal was this peace and tranquility that I don't have to deal with this anymore. That the house would go on the market and it would sell. And then my mom receives the proceeds. Okay, see how that is just so much more peaceful than a pile of stuff that I cannot fit in my house. So keep the end goal in mind, whatever that end goal for you is. Maybe the end goal for you is that you really want to be in a smaller place, or you really want to find that perfect place for your mom or for your dad, or you want your loved one to live closer to you. Whatever reason you have for decluttering a large space or a whole house, or for downsizing, maybe you're downsizing to do van life. Whatever it is, keep that end goal in mind, and it's gonna continue to motivate you until you get to that end goal. All right, friends, so that's the 10 things I learned from decluttering a whole house in 6 weeks. 1, you can't do it alone. 2, you will make a lot of decisions. 3, you will make continuous decisions. Number 4, declutter one section at a time. Number 5, you'll encounter unexpected sentimental clutter. 6, sentimental clutter can be handled in different ways. 7, it's okay to not be okay. 8, be open to new solutions. 9, hire help if you can. And 10, keep the end goal in mind. I hope this video has been helpful. Watch the next video as we talk about work-life balance. I hope this video has been helpful. Just know that I am holding your hand. You've got this. You can do it. I understand. Let me know in the comments below. Again, any advice that you have for our community. And if you're looking for a checklist on decluttering, click the link in the description box for your free PDF. If you need help decluttering, I've created a free PDF checklist, 24 things to declutter. They're quick and easy, and probably things you've been thinking about letting go of. Well, here's your sign to do so. Click the link in the show notes below, put in your email, and you'll receive the download immediately. You've got this.